coming to you live from the Conversation Room, deep in the heart of the Central Valley. This is the Almond Man Podcast, hosted by the one and only Russell Harris. Are you ready to get nuts?
All right, man, welcome to the Almond Man Podcast from Nashville, Shaun Silva's studio, Tackle Box Films. Man, I'm so happy to be here with you, and great to see you again.
Great to see you.
Hey, man, so why don't you give us a little story of how you ended up in Nashville, coming from a little town of Chowchilla,
yep,
where we were raised, and yep, how did you end up here doing this fantastic stuff with all these music stars and you're doing these films with? I think it's super cool.
Well, the video career started with the legendary Kenny Rogers. So that was really, Kenny Rogers was the first legit artist that I ever worked with. Oh, see, my brother Scott's gonna be mad because I said he was the first legit artist I ever worked with, because Scott actually was the first country act I ever worked with, my brother Scott Silva, because he had a local country band.
All right, and you had the little VHS machine you stick in, yeah, your camera. He's a little kid, you're walking around as a 13-year-old filming. I remember all this stuff, yeah, all the country, at the, what's it, the, with the Stampede, he did a concert, yeah, there after that, talking about, yeah, the Stampede.
Yeah, he would open for a lot of artists that came to town and played the local fairs and stuff, and, you know, so I'd run around and film him, and but I moved to Los Angeles in 1990 and kind of just, you know, started learning the craft, you know. I just fetching coffees, doing whatever I could do to be around it, you know, and working for some really talented people. But by mid to late 90s, you know, I wanted to start creating some of my own stories.
You were an actor. When did you become an actor?
I did. I started. Well, you always got to start out in LA as an actor. You know,
were you on any shows?
I did. You know, I'd do little bit parts on like the soap opera Santa Barbara. It was at NBC Studios, right across the street from my apartment at the time. And my buddy and I, actually Brian Good, who still lives in Fresno, he's the one that convinced me to move to LA with him for the summer. I stayed quite a bit.
I can see why you would be an actor. You're a handsome guy. Okay.
Well, thank you. Thank you. But that was fun. I mean, I get bit parts on things, and then, you know, I worked as an extra on like Saved by the Bell and,
yeah,
stuff. And
really?
Yeah, it was fun. It's fun. And it was good. All those guys became friends. LA was a fun time, but at a certain point, you're like, okay, what am I gonna do? And for me, I wasn't really good at just hanging out and being like a bartender while I was hoping for the opportunity to be an actor. That just wasn't my thing. I wanted to work. Mm-hmm. And so I just started working as a PA, production assistant. And like I said, I mean, I would just, I'd drive trucks, I'd load trucks, you know, and just learn and watch and learn every day. And got to a point where I felt like, you know what, let's try it. And I'm going to find out pretty quickly if I've got a knack for this or not. And
Behind the camera.
Behind the camera. And, you know, put together at the time, you know, a little sizzle reel of stuff. I went back to Chowchilla and shot a commercial, a Ford commercial for my dad.
Yeah.
And that turned out really great, and started shopping that stuff around. And that was actually the thing that got Kenny Rogers' attention. He loved it. And he's like, you know, I'm doing this. I just recorded a song called
So how'd Kenny see? How'd Kenny see what you produced? How'd Kenny see it?
I had a friend who knew Kenny's TV department guy. The guy that ran his TV department was actually in LA, Kelly Unkerman. And it was Dreamcatcher Entertainment. And I dropped my reel of work, which was a VHS of work, off with him. And he showed it to Kenny Rogers. And I literally got a phone call out of the blue. I was home one day, I get a phone call, and it's this woman, and she says, is this Shaun Silva? And I said, yes, ma'am. And she says, I have Kenny Rogers on the phone for you. And
no,
I was
way,
like,
no,
I was
way,
like, okay, I know that I dropped my reel off with his people, but is this really Kenny Rogers or is this just Scott?
And
just
this is in the 90s? Is this 90s? 90?
Something yeah, this is this was late 90s.
And Kenny's career wasn't on fire back then, was it?
No, it kind of fizzled, yeah. Right? It wasn't. He wasn't doing a lot at that point. And, you know, I was like, man, I don't know if someone's just messing with me or what. So I stay on the phone, and all of a sudden, you know, I'm talking to the gambler. You know, I'm like, what is happening
right
now?
Know when to hold him and when to fold him, yeah, okay? Right? He's You're like, from Churchill. You know how to do that.
Yeah, he's like, hey, he says, Shaun, I saw your work, and, you know, we're looking for somebody to do a video, and, you know, it's about this little boy that's trying to hit a baseball, and it's called The Greatest, and, you know, would you be interested? I'm like, oh, my God, yeah. He goes, okay, can you write a treatment for us? I'm like, write a treatment, okay. I'll learn how to do that.
What does treatment mean?
You write a concept for it, right? And back then, it's like, I'm like, okay, I haven't done that before, but I will, you know? And so I wrote a concept for him, and I part of the thing was that, they didn't want to spend a ton of money. So I said, well, if we can do this in my hometown, I know the perfect little baseball diamond to do this at, and if we can get Kenny to come in, if you can come in, then you know, do it. So, you know, all of a sudden he's like, man, I love this idea. I think it's great.
Where diamond you go? Wasn't it Fireball?
Fireball.
Yeah, you went to Fireball.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember
yeah,
that.
So I remember that little baseball diamond that I used to pass all the time going from like Fresno to Los Banos or Dos Palos. Yeah, yeah. You know, you'd go through Fireball the back way.
Yeah, right,
and,
right.
Right, and you'd see this little baseball diamond that looked like...
It's on Highway 33. I still see it.
Yeah, I'm sure you see it plenty. Yeah. You know, so that was in my mind, you know, and he flew into Madera, you know, with his jet, and my dad went over and picked him up, you know, which was a highlight for him to be able to go pick up Kenny Rogers, and he brought him to set, and then we spent the day with him, and it was cool.
Little boy in a baseball hat stands in the field with his ball and bat. Says, I am the greatest player of them all. Puts his bat on his shoulder and he tosses up his ball.
How many people did you have? Were you doing all by yourself then, filming it by yourself? You had people helping you a little bit at that time?
Well, back then, you know, everything was shot on film still. So we didn't have these digital cameras that you can run around with, and it, you know, it's, you know.
So a heavy piece of equipment.
I'm yeah, guessing, I mean, right? You had to have professional lighting, you know, gaffers and a cinematographer that actually knew film, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. And made sure you were exposed properly for film. Because back then, you know, people were really careful about who they hired, because if all of a sudden you shot this project on film and then you go into the processing to look at the film and everything's underexposed or overexposed, it's ruined. Mm-hmm. You've just wasted thousands and thousands of dollars. Nowadays, it's like everything's digital. Well, you can see it on the monitor right now when you're shooting it. Oh, it looks good. Okay, great. No problem.
Using backplate or something.
Yeah, so people, you know, it's just the industry has changed dramatically.
Oh, yeah, for
dramatically.
Sure. Technology has definitely moved on for sure.
Then
you also did with Kenny at the Wagon Wheel, didn't you?
Yeah, we did it. That first video was very successful. It was my first number one video on CMT.
Oh, congratulations.
And then he's like, hey, I've got another song. Let's do it. So we went and did another one. Then he called me again. All of a sudden, things started picking up in Nashville for me. You know, I'm still living in LA, mm-hmm, but people are recognizing my name and they're starting to want to hire me. So I start taking other jobs. And then
was all this coming out on MTV or Country
Music? CMT.
CMT at that time. CMT. Okay.
Yeah, CMT at the time. So I started working, but I was working in Nashville, and it seemed like where LA didn't really gravitate towards that Americana kind of visual, because that's what I knew. That's what I grew up with,
right,
in the San Joaquin Valley. Yeah. That's what we were just talking about this. But mm-hmm, that's what I knew, and that's what was, those were the stories that I related to the most. And it didn't resonate in LA. So it was hard for me to get a job in LA. But it did resonate in Nashville. So I'm like, well, maybe I should go out to Nashville. So I fly out to Nashville, didn't know anybody here, and ended up signing with a company, and they represented me And then all of a sudden I started getting, there was about a 3 year period of time where I was working, but I still wasn't really making much money. And doing these jobs, and at the end of the job, I'm going, man, how come I'm not making very much money here, you know? Well, and then you learn kind of more about the business, and that, you know, when you're being represented by another company, that company's taking the lion's share, you're getting your director's fee. And, you know, when you're young and you're just trying to make it, you know, sometimes you're throwing in that director's fee just to be able to tell a better story.
So when you're saying director's story, so you go out and film something, you're giving this film to someone else after it's edited, and you want them to go ahead and, what do you mean by directing it after that? I'm confused a little bit.
Well, no, as a director, you come up
you're
with
the director, right?
I'm the director.
Yeah, okay.
So I come up with the concept, I have the vision, and then I hire a producer, and he helps me get all the people and all the equipment and all the things I need to be able to tell that story.
Okay.
Right. So it's my vision, right? And I get paid, let's just say it's 10%, right? A 10% is like a standard for, we'll stay in the music video world for now, right? Mm-hmm. So you get 10%, whatever the budget is, that's what you get. But when, as a young kid, and I'm just trying to work with better and better and better and bigger artists, it's hard to make some of those budgets work. So I was contributing.
Yeah, you want to give up, saying, you want to sacrifice so I can get in front of this guy. So like,
yeah,
good friend Kenny Chesson, I want you to prove yourself, man. You're his guy.
Yeah, I'll give up, you know, I'll pay $5,000 for that whatever thing that I want, a helicopter shot or whatever it is. I'll pay for it, you know? So, so I just, there was only one place for me to kind of give, right, as the director, was from my director's fee. So after about 3 years and establishing myself with people like Kenny Chesney, Brooks and Dunn, Rascal Flatts, certainly, you know, some of those early artists that were really growing as I was growing, you know, we grew together. And I started my own company, which is Tacklebox Films. And that started in 2003. And I was already established here and living here. And, you know, and just kind of
hit. So that's 10 years. You worked 10 years to get there.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So it just kind of started from there. And now at that point, when I had my own company, then I realized that, okay, you know, now I can contribute as a company who's also getting 15% of that budget. And there's just a lot of different ways.
Has your business changed a lot because people, they got cell phones now where they can record and they try to make their own videos, or does that happen? Is that YouTube? Has that done any?
It's the YouTube is literally has killed the industry.
Yeah.
Literally killed the industry.
No.
But it's killed it and advanced it. And for me, it's like, you know, I'm not one of those guys, I'm going to sit here and be like, oh man, this sucks. You know,
No, you got to get up and work. You got to get to work, man.
Yeah, you learn
how to get out of it.
Yeah, you learn and you adapt.
Right.
Right. So, again, I think that the advantage that I have is that I've established a company now that started in 2003, you know, here almost 20 years. We've had a good foothold in Nashville. We're a trusted company. We've delivered time and time and time again. So, but we've also,
all the awards you won have showed that you've done a good job. Show me all those country music awards you win and all that stuff.
We've had some great success. We've also been very fortunate to work with some really great artists that have stuck with me over the years.
Well, they stick with you because you're a good guy. You do a good job. You know what you're doing. People don't stick with people that they don't like or don't trust or don't feel they're getting a value.
Yeah.
So all your artists seem to be sticking with. That's awesome.
Yeah,
I think it's super.
But we've evolved the company too. We don't do as much in the music space as we used to. I'll never walk away from it because I just have too many great relationships and friendships, quite frankly, in the music space.
And plus, it's fun to do,
and I love it.
Yeah,
I love it. You know, I love going out now. You know, with Kenny, we help him with his tour design, so we're involved in, you know, what is the content that's playing behind him on the big screen when he's on stage. You know, we're developing and creating all that content for him. We've done that for a lot of artists, Jason Aldean, Rascal Flatts, you know, a lot of artists over time. So, and even a lot of the young artists that we're working with now, it's great to see them and be part of kind of helping to launch their careers as well. But we've evolved as a company, we've started doing more long form documentaries, which you've seen. We're working on our sixth documentary for ESPN now. We've done a lot of music docs for artists. One I just showed you a clip of with Cody Johnson that features Reba McEntire.
Super cool.
And really cool stuff. And it's positive stuff, you know. It's like, it's things that I can sink my teeth into, you know. I want to influence people in positive ways. And that's kind of, again, I think it gets back to how I grew up, where I grew up, and what's kind of the values that are important to me. So
yeah, it's starting from a VHS at 13 to here is pretty amazing story. How many people really know that, you know?
Yeah,
very know that. And so then you were here, you met your lovely wife Shannon, you have two wonderful little boys, and they're a lovely couple. Had a little dinner with them last night, can't wait to see them again. Your boys love sports.
You were talking a lot of sports with them last night. They're way into college football. I don't know how they became OU fans. Well, I do know how they became OU fans. My father-in-law recruited them very early. So, but they're big OU fans. They both want to go to OU. So we'll see.
It's a good school.
We'll see what happens.
How far is Oklahoma from here for drive?
Oh, God.
Three hours. Long ways.
It's a long way. Yeah, it's a ways.
Flying, I guess.
It's a ways. My brother-in-law actually drives in for Christmas and stuff, you know, on the holidays and stuff. So it's drivable, but it's a drive.
Hey, what's COVID? Let's talk about COVID a little bit. Man, for the music industry, that's had to really do a lot of damage. I feel sorry for the people that used to set the stage up. And that they weren't doing that no more. Yeah. And how has that affected some of the artists here?
I mean, well, it's had a huge effect on live music, obviously, you know, not being able to go out and tour. You know, it was interesting, like with Kenny, he took a year off and then last year was going to have a big stadium tour. And then all of a sudden COVID hit. So he was forced to take that year off. And then this year has been so in the balance, you don't know if he's going to go out. So he's really almost, you know, 3 years off. And that's a bummer because we're like a family, all of us. You know, he treats his road family is his road family. I mean, it is. So we miss each other. We spend a lot of time out on the road together, all of us. And it's just such a, it's such a fun world to be part of. It's, you know, we were talking
energy, about the energy, a lot of energy.
Yeah, I mean, it's so cool to be able to, you know, you're living on a tour bus, you wake up in the morning and you're in a different city, you know, in a different stadium or in a different arena. And it's a lot of work. And I think it's not for everyone.
No,
you know,
for sure.
It's definitely
but
not.
You were mentioning last night, you think that outdoor seating, music's going to start because of COVID. It'll be more outdoor seating, less indoor concerts for a while.
Yeah, I mean, it's happening. The festivals and stuff are starting to ramp back up, and it'll be interesting to see how they manage the audience as far as putting them in pods and things like that. I know they're doing some of that stuff right now. Mm-hmm. So, the problem with that is it's really tough to make money.
Yeah.
Because you're giving up so many tickets, right? And
space.
And right now, you know, we talked about YouTube and, you know, a lot of the distribution companies that makes the music so accessible. It's hard for artists to make money on music, right? Like they used to make a lot of money on radio plays, and now a lot of it's digital. And the payout is not even close to what it was for radio. So they really make their living touring.
I didn't know that.
And playing shows. So it's been it's had a major impact on
they got to work a lot harder.
Yeah.
Too.
So it's not only the crews and the people that, you know, keep the wheels turning underneath their tours, but, you know, also them. It's had a huge impact on them. And, you know, you look at a lot of the big artists, certainly they've made lots of money and they're probably in a better position than some, but these younger artists that are coming up, that's really how they make a living. I mean, listen, when I met Shanna, my wife, she was a new artist, and I scratched my head. I'm going, man, I don't understand. How do you make money? Like
you gotta sell tickets.
Yeah,
I guess,
you gotta get on. You immediately go into debt when you sign a record deal because they spend all this money on you. So now everything's recoupable that you're
really?
Making.
So you sign a contract, they spend the money, tell them you owe it back.
Yeah.
Really?
Exactly.
Oh, I didn't.
So I'm going, okay. I'm not sure I understand this concept. But then once you get out on the road and you're an opening act for a big tour, after you've had some success, then you're getting paid and your band's getting paid. And then, and you just build it. You just keep building it. Right. But it's touring and merchandise. And, that's where you make your money. So it's, COVID has been tough on a lot of people.
Did COVID affect your business directly too then?
It did. It did the production side as far as going out and filming, but I also own a post-production company, which is all the editing and the final delivery, color correction, all those things.
Why don't you explain what post-production is to a layman, to a person like myself or some of our almond grower listeners.
Yeah, so production is the creative. It's like coming up with the concept, going out and achieving the concept, telling the story, right? So you have to go out and film it. It's physical. You bring all of that media back, and a lot of production companies and a lot of directors will hire a post-production company that has editors that will then help you put that story together, right? So now you're taking all that media, and it may be for a music video, it might be a few hours of footage that you're cutting down to 3.5 minutes. On a documentary, like I was telling you, this one we're doing for the ESPN right now. That's going to be ultimately be a 90-minute documentary. Well, I've shot over 40 interviews that are an hour a piece. So by the time we're done with that, it'll be 50 hours of footage that I have four editors working on.
You got to go through every hour.
Yeah, and you're finding all those diamonds, right? You're looking for all the best of the best moments to help tell that story. Right? That's post-production. So I had a post-production company, and what happened when COVID hit, people started going, hey, we can't go out and film anything, but what do you have in the archive? What can we put together from what you have in-house? Or, so my editors actually kept fairly busy, and there were some jobs that had been started before COVID that they continued working on through COVID. Now, they couldn't come to the office, so I told everybody, go to the office, grab your computers, take them home, and right. Everybody's going to work remotely. And we did that for 6 to 8 weeks, and then everybody started going, man, we're ready to come back in the office. Everybody really wanted to come back in the office, and when they're in the office here, we can control this environment.
You got a super cool office. I'd like to do some video shots so I can show you what on my podcast that you're directing right now, and you can do the pre and post production of.
Yeah.
So I'd like to show this office. It's just super cool for the viewers, man. This is nice.
Yeah, that one of the things that we did during COVID, how we kind of transitioned, how we adapted, right, was we turned my conference room, which is three walls of glass, and it's supposed to look like it's a floating conference room. That I designed it, we turned it into a studio. So we've done performances here. We've done podcasts here. So Chuck Wick's podcast, Talk to Chuck, is every week we film here. But, this was conceptualized out of, COVID. I mean, it's, again, you just got to adapt. You got to figure out ways to adapt to what's going on. So we're doing a lot of live streams and stuff. So, we did one with Miranda last night for Tractor Supply, and that was cool. But,
That was a cool building we're in it too. You said your friend owns that. Don't listen. It doesn't let very many people in it at all.
No, not at all. We shot in Green's Grocery, which is out in Leapers Fork, Tennessee. It's this really small little town outside of Nashville that has become kind of the it place to be. The properties are big. What I call farms, you wouldn't call them farms because they're not really farming.
I call them estates, and they go, they got farms. And for our listeners out, when they farm, they don't really farm anything. They have a few, maybe a cow on it or something, but there's like 20 acres they call
horses,
a farm.
Yeah. Horses, a barn, a barn that they may turn into an event space or something, but they're really beautiful, beautiful places. Oh, and there are some places out there that where they're raising competitive horses for either horse jumping and things like that as well. So I know you guys got out there, it was dark, so you couldn't see.
No, we got there before dark. It was actually beautiful.
Yeah, it's
beautiful,
gorgeous, state.
Some houses were on a hill. It looked like a...
Yeah.
It was just fantastic. And everything's green here.
Yeah. And it's a little outside of town, so it is a place that people like to retreat to. But it's beautiful. But this little place, Green's Grocery, has got a lot of history. And my friend owns it, and he doesn't let very many people in there anymore because in the late 90s, it really blew up. It was like, you know, Garth Brooks played there, Keith Urban played there, my wife actually played there. A lot of artists played there. They would frequent there, and it became almost like a Bluebird kind of thing. And then it got too big, and he's like, I don't need this to become a job for me. I have a job, you know. So he kind of shut it down and keeps it as more of a private venue for just, you know, the people that he trusts and appreciates that how they will treat it. That's really what it comes down to, because there is so much history inside there, as you saw.
Yeah.
It's really cool. So it worked out great for us, and we, you know, did the show in there and then went down the road to Puckett's and listened to a little bit of open mic night, which was interesting.
It was fun there. It was fun.
And had some, you know, some cool. I told you it was kind of like Pioneer Market on steroids.
It wasn't. Yeah, it was Pioneer Market on steroids. That's for sure.
But I loved Pioneer Market growing up, you know, in Chowchilla, and going to breakfast with my dad at Pioneer Market, which was a market with a kitchen in the back.
Right.
And that was so cool because you got to see all the farmers and everything every morning. You'd bump into all kinds of fun people.
Yeah, Pioneer Market's not the same anymore, Shaun. It's just changed a little bit, you know, not the same people there anymore.
Well, I'm referring back to what, 30?
Yeah, 30 years
30
ago.
30 years ago. We're so old. Yeah, so anyway, we're more.
When are you going to come back to, you don't get back to California much. You're too busy.
Well, we haven't. I mean, honestly, you know, Dad, and I want to thank you for flying my father and Linda, his wife, in, my stepmom in, because, you know, listen, I have not seen my dad in 3 years.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I love your dad. Your dad was the he was my coach when I was playing a little Pop Warner football. He was in charge of the Pop Warner football. I don't know if you knew that or not. And I won punt, pass, and kick 3 years in a row. And so with the Ford was putting that on, he would always take me these trips. And I say, man, I cannot kick the ball. I could not kick the ball off the tee. I tried to, I don't know, kick it straight, not soccer style, and I would lose all the time. But I had a lot of great memories of your father. We bought a lot of trucks from him. He was just always a good man. I love him to death. He's got a lot to say.
Yeah. Well, I remember being a kid hanging out at the dealership and you and your dad and everybody coming in, and you guys would walk in just straight out of the field, you know, covered in mud or whatever, you know, and it was just like, I just loved it. I mean, it was like so normal for me. It's like, I don't know. I miss that.
Small,
you know,
towns.
I think that's why I like Leaper's Fork area, because you'll see some of that.
Yeah.
You know, and the guys just coming in from the fields and stuff, and it's just cool. I miss it.
But you've done some pretty crazy things filming, you know. For people who don't know that, you were in a helicopter accident hanging out or something, right? Filming. Why don't you give us a little story about that?
Yeah.
And you actually saved Buston and got the guys out of the helicopter when you crashed, too.
Yeah, so basically what happened was, it was interesting because it kind of goes back to me starting my own company. In 2003, when I started my own company, the first job that we did, and I was just working out of the basement of my house that my wife and I had just bought, our first house. And we got our first gig, and it was with Kenny, and it was for There Goes My Life. And there's this one scene at the end of that video.
That was in the song, There Goes My Life.
Yeah, ironic.
Yeah, right? yeah.
So so what happened, we shoot this whole video, and here's a cool little thing. So the actress that I hired for that video, that goes off to California in the story, she leaves and goes to California to pursue her dreams, and, you know, that actress, it was her first gig ever. Her name is Amy Heard, who married Johnny Depp.
That crazy breakup thing. Yeah, I know who she
That's
is.
That's Amy Heard.
Yeah.
I gave her her first gig.
Really?
She's in There Goes My Life.
There goes my life. There goes my future. My everything. I love you, baby. Goodbye.
So we've spent 2 days filming this whole thing, and it's kind of this Friday Night Lights. Before Friday Night Lights was Friday Night Lights, it was this concept video. And we were supposed to shoot a helicopter shot where it's her driving her car out this road toward going to the West Coast. And it got rained out. There was weather coming in, so pilot couldn't do it. So we go home, and then a week later, we go back out to Texas where we shot the video. We go back out there to do it. I show up just to shoot this one shot, and I took Shannon with me. I said, well, just come out with me. We're just going to go do this one helicopter shot. Get there, and it's...
She's not in the helicopter with
me. No.
Okay.
We get there, and it's a different pilot. Now, I'd rehearsed this and scouted this whole thing with one pilot. And then when I come back, because it got canceled, they switched pilots on me. So I get there, and it's like this different pilot. And I'm like, I don't know how I feel about that.
Yeah.
You know? So I'm walking towards the helicopter. Shannon's standing behind me with my producer. And as I'm walking, Shannon goes, there goes my life. There goes my everything, which is the line in the song. I'm like, I kind of shrug her off. I'm like,
we're gonna be fine.
I'm like, whatever, you know. So I get in the helicopter, and all of a sudden my mind starts kind of swirling. I'm like,
So you got the pilot and two other people in there, right?
Yeah, the cinematographer and the pilot.
Okay.
And I go, you know what? Never hurts to say a little prayer here.
Yeah.
So I say a little prayer, and we go up. And we come around, and you line up and get behind the car, and we start getting down low behind the
car.
Are you
on the country? Is there telephone poles? Or
Yeah. It's a two-lane road out in the country.
Oh, so you're in the kind of a desert.
Outside of Austin, Texas.
Oh, okay. Not in the city or nothing like that.
It's sunset shot, you know, so we're going into the sun.
Oh.
So there was this point when the helicopter was supposed to drop in behind the car, right? And it's very specific because there were power lines.
Kind of important to miss them.
Yeah, so you go after the lines.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
So we go, and all of a sudden he dips in behind the car, and I'm sitting there, and I'm looking at my monitor, right, of what the camera's filming, and I'm in the back of the helicopter, right behind the...
Where's the camera? Is the camera hanging off like a...
It's on the nose.
It's on the nose, and you can control it from the nose.
So there's two... You can do a nose mount, or you can do a side mount.
Okay.
And a nose mount is remote, right? So he's controlling it with a board, and it's on the nose, right? So we drop in behind it. I'm sitting there, and I'm going, man, where's those power lines? Because I would see the power lines go under us. I'm like, where's those power lines? I don't see the power lines. And I look up, and right as I look up, I see the power lines in front of us. And I yell at the guy. I yell because the pilot's mistake that he made was he was watching the monitor instead of watching his flight line. So I go, cables in my headset, which he can hear. And he looks up and sees the cables, and split second decision, goes down to try and go under him. Because if he would have pulled up, we're done. So he goes down to try and go under the cable. It catches one cable and rips the rotors off the helicopter.
Oh, the rotors hit it.
Yep.
No. Oh.
Rips the rotors off the helicopter, which I learned later.
Did you get tangled up in the wire though?
No. We're going 75 miles an hour. We ain't stopping.
No.
We're going 75 miles an hour behind this car.
Oh.
So rips the rotors off the helicopter, and I learned later that was a blessing, because a lot of times what happens when you hit the ground, those rotors are still spinning, then they're just destroying everything.
Yeah.
They'll flex down or whatever. They just start destroying everything in their way. So those are shredded off and fly off into the fields around us. And now all we have to do really is survive impact. Right? So the good news is we're going 75 miles an hour. So we hit the road and we just start skipping like a rock.
Oh,
so really? We hit the skids, and that thing just like the skids collapse, which I know now is supposed to happen. So the skids, so that absorbs some of it. And we're just like skipping and sliding
so
down
didn't
this
roll
road.
Over or nothing.
Not yet. So we're skipping
Not
and
yet.
Sliding.
Not yet.
Not yet. So we're skipping and sliding. I'm sitting in the back just going, I'm going to die. I'm just waiting for the moment. I'm not screaming. I'm not doing anything. Everything was really slow motion.
Oh.
And then what happens is that we're sideways sliding, and it goes off the road. Well, as soon as it goes off the road, now it's not sliding. No, now it's tumbling.
Yeah.
So it's flipping and it's going like light, dark, light, dark, light, dark. And I'm just going, I'm just waiting. I'm like, okay, there's going to be that one impact.
Can you see belted in?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm just, so in my mind, I'm going, it's going to be the one thing. I'm going to, there's going to be one impact. There's going to be something that's going to, that's going to be it. Right?
I don't know what to say.
And all of a sudden it just stops. And it, and it's just crazy noises. Just like, you still hear the engine trying to work. You still hear like sirens are going crazy. You're hearing all these just really bad noises.
Yeah.
Noises you don't want to hear.
No.
Right? And
I don't like when my plane goes beep, 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 beep. I don't know what that means, but it ain't good.
It ain't good. So, so then he, the, so then I hear the pilot say, you got to get out there. We have fire. Right? So yeah. And I'm looking down, I'm kind of hanging like a little bit upside down and I see, okay, yeah, there's fire. And I, so this hatch, he opens this hatch up top and I jump, I climb out and then I just run across this, the street because I'm, and I'm covering my head as if that's going to do something. I don't know. You're just
shock.
Reacting,
you're in shock.
Right?
You're in shock.
So I'm running across the road. I'm covering my head like this. I turn around and I look back at the, at, you know, the helicopter like burning and the, and then that the cinematographer is still in it and the helicopter pilot's trying, pulling on the cinematographer to get him out because his legs were kind of wrapped up in some of the rigging and stuff. So I ran back over, but it was really a weird moment because it was like when I turned around and looked at it, it was almost like this out of body kind of experience.
I'm sure.
And then it's just like all of a sudden you're back in it and I run across and I grab and we both grab and pull him out and then he gets up and he's like walking. So we're like, okay, he's good. You know, and then there's these truckers and stuff that are pulling over and they're got their fire extinguishers and they're trying to put this thing out. And I just start walking and I start walking back the other direction. And the girl that was a stunt driver that was driving the car that we were chasing, she's freaking out because she thought we were dead because she sees the helicopter explode behind her. Because all the fuel and everything just goes there. And she just thought we were dead. She's like, I thought you were dead, you know. And I said, go back, tell Shannon and my producer, please go back and tell them we're okay. So she goes back and they didn't hear it. They couldn't hear from where they were. They were down, they were far enough away over the rise, so they didn't hear anything. But when they came flying up, I was just wandering. And I was picking up pieces of film, like the camera was just destroyed and I'm picking up stuff and I'm just like,
you're in shock.
And she comes flying up and, you know, Shannon's like bawling and I'm just like looking at her and just like nothing.
Well,
it was weird for a while.
At least she knows she loves you. she loves you a lot.
Yeah.
She wasn't going, you know.
Yeah. So anyway, so we had to go to the hospital, everybody get checked out. And I called Kenny, I said, hey, our helicopter crashed. He's like, what? You know, and he's just like, are you okay? And all this stuff, you know. And then I said, man, we're good. We lived.
Did you ever get the film? You got the film shot on when that happened?
No, because it was film.
Oh, and you saw,
it was just like a string of film like broke out everywhere. And look, back then it was like, we had cell phones, but they weren't smartphones.
No.
So there is one picture of it, which I think is on an old computer of mine where you see the wreckage and it's all charred and stuff and the caution tape and everything. And you're sitting there going, you were in that?
Yeah.
Like how?
That's crazy. Yeah. I don't know. That's crazy. I've never been anything like that. Well, yeah. I'm glad you survived.
Thank you.
I'm glad you survived.
Yeah. It's been a lot of life since then, you know? And honestly, I think it was one of those kind of moments, defining moments in my life where I just kind of went, you know what, I'm just gonna embrace every moment and live every day. And you know, and I feel like I have.
Well,
so
I don't know if I can much more want to talk about leaving the life. That's pretty yeah. that's leaving on a good
that's
note.
A good one, man. We could always do it again some other time. We can talk about some other stuff.
I do want to come back and we'll talk. I want to get your dad on the podcast. It'd be great to get old Bob on here.
Absolutely.
But hey, man, thanks for having me here. Thanks for your play. Enjoy me to your, and let me look at your place and enjoy your company and everything else. And I'm so happy to bless to have friends like you and relationships like you have, and because we all grown from a small town, and as you get older, I think you appreciate that more and more and more.
Well, I want to say this too. I'm proud of you. Oh, thank you. Because I mean, you, your family, it's always been a family that growing up in Chowchilla that, you know, we always admired your hardworking family. And I mean, I think, you know, what you've done with the family business and how you've taken it to, you know, heights that, I mean, unimaginable. I mean, good for you.
I got lucky. Awesome. I got lucky. I was in the right place at the right time. Yeah. Kind of like we all are, right?
Yeah, you
got
to work, though, man.
Anyways, hey, thank you. God bless you and your family, man.
Thank you so much.
All right, Sean.
All right, buddy.
Bye.
Thanks for listening to the Almond Man Podcast, hosted by the one and only Russell Harris. Let's give a special shout out to the team at Root Creative. Until next time, take care and prosper.